definition, which we all understand. So that is the purpose of this class. And let me first quickly recap so that we are all. I can't go back to the slide. Okay. So anyway, so I had a slide on the previous. Sorry, the slides are not flipping. Okay, sorry. Okay, I would request everybody to kindly put your laptops on mute. So in the earlier discussions, we had talked about the evolution of enabling technologies which lead to digital revolution. And then we have spoken about the digital economy. So just to recap, the digital economy is a result of intersections over the internet. And this is very important. Emphasize it is intersections over the internet. Okay, between its primary participants, which are shown here, which are the people, businesses, data, devices, and processes. For example, we discussed that when people and processes or people and applications intersect on the internet, the concept of cloud is evolved. So we will be discussing today on these aspects more. So, and we also discussed that the key enablers or drivers of the digital economy are the explosion of data. And we talked about IP-centric platforms, both innovation platforms and transaction platforms. We talked about abundance of bandwidth and the proliferation or the spread of smart devices like laptops, smartphones, and stuff like that. And of course, this is driven by a continuous hunger for information. Everybody is seeking more information, more options, more sort of data. So this has led to the emergence of the digital economy. This is essentially what we discussed. And one important point that I wish to reemphasize here is that while the old economy was bound by capital, labor, by capital, I mean the physical capital, the capital, labor, and raw material, the new economy relies heavily on intellectual capital or innovation for its evolution and growth. So this is what we covered. And we also discussed the creation of the digital enterprise as the most critical business outcome of the digital economy. The digital enterprise is the outcome of, we have discussed that it is the outcome of integrating digital technologies in all areas of the business, not just in a particular area, but in all areas of the business through a process known as digital transformation, which is what we shall talk about today. So I just want to state here that today we'll be talking about digital transformation and also covering the key technology enablers of the digital transformation and how they are used in business. So there's a lot to cover in this class, so I might have to cover with a little bit of a higher speed. But the good thing is that most of the concepts that I'm talking about are already familiar to you. So, but in case you find that I'm going a little bit fast in order to cover the whole, I don't want us to deviate from the schedule of the lectures. So I want to cover whatever we had planned for today's class. So just bear with me and stop me to ask questions. And before we go into a definition of digital transformation, I just want to say that, see, this digital transformation, unlike many of the other subjects like which you study, like mathematics or networking or others, or networks or other engineering subjects that you may be studying, digital transformation is not an exact science. Okay, so therefore, as in my last lecture where we spoke about the digital economy, I'm going to leave you with general principles and concepts. There is no rigid framework here that nothing can be outside of that or more can't be interpreted out of what I'm saying. One can only leave the audience with a general concept of what is digital transformation. The entire digital enterprise ecosystem rests upon the ability of people such as yourselves to use these concepts innovatively and translate an idea into a clear competitive advantage for the enterprise. So we talk about the concept and then it is up to you how these concepts can be used as sort of building blocks to convert an idea into a competitive advantage for a company or an institution or an organization that you work for. So this is basically the essence of digital transformation. In this class, we'll be discussing the use of various technologies that drive business operations in the digital world, specifically about how they have brought in a new convergence of people, technology, and businesses and disrupted the existing order of business. Today, business is very different from what it was before the digital economy. So we'll be talking about how this has been disrupted to create the new business ecosystem. So this was basically a sort of a background. Now we'll move on to today's. Let's talk about what is the digital transformation. In order to understand digital transformation, there are three concepts that we should be clear about, especially the people here, all of us here who, as engineers, we should understand not only the business aspect, which is what we will be talking about, but also how is there are three concepts that one needs to be clear about when we talk about digital transformation. The first is, and they're all interrelated, by the way, that's why I've shown them as a step. The first concept is known as digitization. Digitization was the first thing to happen. Digitization is simply converting some piece of information into a binary format. Like, for example, the number 5 can be written in hexadecimal as 0101. So that is, I have digitized the number 5. So basically, all computer technology is, as of course, as we know, is digital because it is based on the binary system. So digitization is for objects and artifacts, for example, for information. Information is an artifact. So, for example, we have very many familiar examples that we do everything every day using this process of digitization. For example, scanning a photograph to create a digital file, or converting a paper report to a digital format such as PDF. Basically, you are converting a paper format into a digital format. So that is known as digitization. Or, for example, recording a presentation such as this one, or phone call, turning a sound or video into a digital file which can be stored or transmitted and shared. So basically, converting information, as I said, into a binary format of ones and zeros. This is digitization. I hope you are all clear. Digitization is the most basic. Even in 1980, when computers were first introduced, or before that also, they used to work on this binary system. That means digitization was done of information. That is essentially what happened. Now, next is we talk about the next thing is digitalization. The keyword is digitalization as opposed to digitization. So digitalization, what is digitalization? Just as we said that digitization is for information, it converts information into digital format. Digitization automates a process or converts a process from a manual format to a digital format. I'll give you examples. For example, shifting of a business process or operation to a digital platform, let me think of some examples. For example, implementing test automation. A lot of you would be developing software or will be developing software, and you have to test the software. So using software for testing of software is basically to digitalize the process of testing. You move from manual testing to automated testing. Digital communication. Basically, you can digitalize communication also. For example, use of email or social media or voice over IP. This is basically digitalization of information. Or factories and other manufacturing units use, for example, computer-aided design and manufacturing. That is also digitalization. Basically, you are using digital processes to do operations, or you are using the digital means to automate the process. A pre-existing process was there. You use digitalization basically to automate that process. So this is digitalization. So as I said, digitization is for information. Digitalization is for process. So I've written the definition also, if you see in the center below. The use of digital technology, for example, computers to cloud, it can be any digital technology, to improve operations like customer service with digital information at the core. So this uses digital information, but uses another layer on top of it, which is basically software and of course also hardware, to convert a process from a manual format convert is the wrong word, I would say automate a process from a manual format to a digital format. That is digitalization. So with that background, let's come to digital. I hope it is clear what is the difference between digitization and digitalization. Again, to reiterate, I would say digitization is on information. That's why I've used the underlined the word information above. And digitalization is for a process. I can give you other examples also. For example, registration for admission. I'm sure most of you registered for your current admission using a portal, and then you entered information and you registered. The payroll which companies do for their employees, or the procurement processes in companies, all of that is getting digitalized because there are applications and softwares and processes available to automate those processes. So that is known as digitalization. Basically, it's about leveraging digital content to automate, simplify, and automate processes. Okay, now digital transformation is about the transformation of an entire business or unit, not a particular process, but an entire business or unit into the digital way, including digital technologies, digital methods, digital processes, digital skills, culture, mindsets, everything. Of course, technology is at the core, but there are other peripheral attributes also which are as critical for digital transformation. So digital transformation works at the level of a business unit. Digitalization works at the level of a process or a business process. And digitization works at the level of a business artifact, such as information. Okay, I'd like you to some examples of converting a photo into a digital format. So digital transformation projects would typically include, as you can see, since we are talking about a whole business unit, a digital transformation project would typically include several digitalization opportunities. Okay, when you combine several opportunities, not just linearly combine them, but also optimize them, then that's what becomes a digital transformation project. The end goal of digital transformation is, I mentioned it in my last lecture, the end goal of digital transformation is to create a digital enterprise, such as Amazon or Airbnb, more recently and closer to us, IRCTC, the railway ticketing application, or ICICI Bank, mobile banking. All these are examples of digital transformation to create a digital enterprise. And I want to again emphasize, though we have said it, I have also said it, Dr. Mittal has also said it, but let me repeat, that digital transformation is not about just technologies. In fact, people and processes play an equal role in actual digital transformation of an enterprise. It is about managing change at a large scale. If you want me to say it in one sentence, I would say it is about managing change. The word transformation means a large scale change, like a caterpillar transforms into a butterfly. Okay, so it's a change, it's a large scale change. So basically your success in digital transformation depends on your ability to manage large scale change. That is what is critical to remember, which includes technology change, which includes process change, which includes changes in people's skill sets, at several levels, changes in business models. So there are a lot of changes, we will be talking about that. So I hope that though I have been speaking fast, that it is that I'm making sense in terms of defining what is digital transformation, because this must stay with you throughout this course, and maybe much more importantly after this course, when you actually go into your work lives, or when you go for your interviews, or when you go for good jobs in the corporate world, or even in the non-corporate world, these are the concepts that you should be, you'll be always living with. So digital transformation, as we are talking about, just to leave this slide, unifies business and technology into one cohesive unit. Today, as we said in the last class also, that technology and business have become indistinguishable. They are unified together. We'll be talking more about this in a subsequent class when I talk about business technology alignment. But right now, one of the outcomes of digital transformation is that it has unified business and technology, which earlier existed in separate universes, into one cohesive unit. Okay, so that making them quite indistinguishable to one another. Okay, so now I'm moving to the next slide, unless somebody wishes to stop me and ask a question. Because this is an important slide. It is important to know what is digital transformation, and it is important to distinguish it from digitalization and digitization. Many people use these terms casually. Oh, I am digitizing my organization. That doesn't mean that they are going digital transformation. Okay, so it is important to understand these things. Simplest way to understand is one is at process level, one is at information level, one is at process level, and one is at business unit. So this is, you can read about, read this slide at your leisure later on also, but right now, so I'm moving to the next slide in the interest of time. Okay, so why do companies, what is the need? What is the urge? Why should a company become a digital enterprise at all? I mean, there are a lot of companies which have been doing very well even before the digital era came in. So what is the sudden compulsion to go into digital? So there was a survey which was done. In fact, many of us in the corporate world, this was not now, this was about, I think, 8 years ago or so, that was done. And some of the findings from that survey, that what are the top reasons that, or the top benefits that enterprises expect to get out of digital transformation? I will not spend much time on this slide, perhaps a minute or so. First of all, I want you to remember that digital transformation, we will also call it DX. D stands for digital, X stands for transformation. So I'm used to saying the word DX. So sometimes if in my hurry, I say the word DX, don't be sort of confused about what this means. It means digital transformation, DX. Okay, so this DX is always outward facing. It is always outward facing, means it is for the business. There's no compulsion or no motivation for companies to do digital transformation for their internal growth. However, because the companies are transforming digitally for managing the external their external environment better, it also has an impact on their internal operations. But the focus or the goal of digital transformation is always external. That means digital transformation is outward facing. Digital transformation is not driven by internal objectives, as I said, but companies transforming to digital undergo major changes in their internal culture and dynamics also. It's not the reverse. that you want to change your internal dynamics and culture, and therefore you achieve outward focus or business growth. It doesn't work that way. It is always the other way, in the reverse. You focus on growing your business, and in that process, you also transform yourself internally. So one of the first things that most people talked about was that digital transformation helped them to evolve, to meet or meet with evolving customer behaviors and preferences in a much better way, like online channels, instant gratification, personalization. There are certain requirements and expectations that you and I as customers have from companies that are only possible to be met. Most importantly, the constant change. Look at the way an application changes. Every time you open it, there is some or the other new feature because customer expectations have changed, they have evolved. So 55% people, most people go for digital transformation to meet evolving customer behaviors and preferences. Other big areas to meet the growth opportunities in new markets, emerging markets, new business models, digital marketing. A lot of companies are doing digital marketing, so others also have to do it, and outreach, adjacencies. Adjacencies means launching new products in existing markets or taking existing products into new markets. So that was also all facilitated by digital transformation. Increased competitive pressure with business analytics coming in. There's a lot of focus on product differentiation. And differentiation can be achieved in the fastest way through by digital means. Speed to market is important. How fast you launch it. Because if you launch a product today and your competitor launches it, let's say even 10 days later, those 10 days are the period in which your growth is going to be the fastest. So speed to market is the fastest. That's why there's so much pressure on software development people and digital enterprises in general to improve or shorten their product development cycles. Churn management. Churn basically means that, for example, if you are a mobile customer and you're using Airtel and you want to move to Jio, so that means you're churning from Airtel to Jio. So churn and companies don't like their customers to churn. So there's a lot of focus on churn management, how to stop people from churning, understand their reasons why they want to churn. For this is where social media and other things we'll talk about come in. So these are some of the major reasons that companies transform to digital. Then of course, new standards in regulatory and compliance like risk management, data privacy, etc. So these are the primary reasons. And all of these reasons, as you can see, and you will appreciate more and more as you get more connected with the corporate world, that these are very critical drivers of business growth and creators of business value. So you cannot ignore these. And this is why digital transformation is so important to companies. It is a very, so I don't want to spend too much time on this because this is more sort of statistical information, though important, but it is not something that I would like to go into much depth of. Let's talk about Snack. I trust a lot of people have studied or have an idea of what Snack means, because Snack is what powers the digital ecosystem. Just to give you the full form of SMAC, SMAC stands for social, mobile, analytics, and cloud. These are, of course, I'm not saying these are the only four technologies that are critical to digital transformation. There are more technologies evolving like machine learning or artificial intelligence, 3D printing, IoT, there are many. And so, but SMAC is the primary power behind the digital transformation. Without SMAC, at least in today's context, maybe tomorrow the technology landscape will be different. But in today's landscape, SMAC is the most critical powerhouse behind the digital ecosystem. And in the rest of this lecture today, we'll be talking about these four technologies, so SMAC refers to the convergence of four independent technologies that are driving digital business. I'm just reading the definition that we have written here. And these four SMAC technologies help to improve business operations and enable companies to come closer to the customer. We will talk about how. That is our focus. I'm not going to talk about how these technologies are built. If you are interested in that, we can have a separate class on, for example, what are the technologies that promote social media or cloud. We can separately talk about that. But today, our primary focus is going to be using these technologies to improve business and to take advantage of digital transformation rather than going into the depths of the technologies itself. You all know what this is. You all know what is social, but I'm just reiterating it. But what is the sort of driver behind SMAC? The point is that huge amounts of data, which we have been mentioning again and again, is being created by mobile devices and wearable technology, connected devices, sensors, social media. A lot of us do website browsing and all that. So this is leading to a new business models which are built on customer generated data, because there is so much data, you can use that data very productively for business, and that is what SMAC helps you to do. So SMAC is essentially the tool that is leveraged by digital enterprise to take advantage of these new business models which are spawned by the growth in data. I hope it is clear, though I know I'm speaking a bit fast, but I want this to be very clear to you. So it's important to remember that it is the very important point. While each of these technologies is important, but the best results and the best innovation and the best value comes from the intersection of these devices with each other. When you intersect social with mobile, for example, or social with cloud, or cloud with mobile, then that is when the real value is extracted out of this SMAC ecosystem. Hello, did anyone say anything? Okay, so it's important to remember that it is the integration of these four technologies, which is social, mobile, analytics, and cloud, that creates competitive advantage and new business opportunities. So this is basically, I will talk about each of these technologies now in some detail, but it is important to emphasize, because without these, the digital enterprise or digital transformation would not be possible at all. These are the primary enablers or the sort of a platform on which the entire digital transformation rests. Of course, there are many other things. We will be touching on those also. The innovation also that we talk about in the context of digital transformation basically comes around innovative use of these four SMAC elements. So I'm going to the next slide, unless anybody wants to stop me. Okay, the next four slides, I'll be talking about each of these SMAC technologies separately, about their use for business. So let's start with social media. In fact, I'll be very surprised if you are not part of a social media network, any of the people here on this call. It therefore requires no introduction. Social media today has crossed all barriers, or shall I say boundaries, of age, race, status, income, nationality. And it has essentially, the outcome has been that it has made the world a smaller, better informed, and more connected place. So today, if you have a friend in Singapore or in Australia or in the US, it doesn't matter. You send them a message over WhatsApp and it takes, doesn't matter. You could be next door or you could be in the next continent. It doesn't really matter. So it has made the world a smaller, better informed place. Now, to get slightly technical about it in terms of defining what is social media, we are going to talk about its applicability for business. So social media collectively refers to the tools, channels, and applications that allow creation and sharing of content or media, as it is called, which is messages, information, pictures, video, files, etc. We all know that. So it's just a reiteration, but an important reiteration of what we know between people over the internet. So social media, if I have to give a definition of social media that would stay with you, it's social media is basically a collective for medium that promote online collaboration. It enables people to collaborate with each other online, that means over the internet. So social media is basically not a new technology in itself. It's a result of pre-existing technology building blocks like IP networks, networks which you heard about in your previous lecture on Monday, web servers, we have talked about webs, cloud computing, smart devices, applications, all of these came together basically. So social media in itself is not a technology. It is only innovative use of existing technologies to create a new ecosystem. Basically, it is a coming together of these technologies to fulfill an inherent. You see, human beings today, and all of us as human beings, we are so-called social animals. We have a need to mix and mingle. A person who does not mix and mingle and who's isolated, let's say, on an island for his or her entire life, would not evolve as a human being. So this social, the concept of social is part of our human DNA. So basically, social media builds on that. So social media is essentially fulfills an inherent human need to mix and mingle. Okay. So since social media allows instant communication with a large number of constituents, it's an how is it used for companies is what I'm coming to. It is an excellent tool for campaigns and promotions. Okay. As you would have seen, a lot of enterprises are talking to their customers on Facebook. In fact, we get irritated also by their ads, but ads is not the only way. They are talking one-on-one also to customers on Facebook, Twitter, and similar platforms, both on a collective and individual level. Now, before I go further, let's look at some of the advantages and benefits. I'm not going to read through all of them because you can all read it. More than that, I want to talk about the concepts which are not on this slide. The top benefits of social media are on the left. increase awareness and interaction of our brands, or for example, increase customer satisfaction, generate new ideas for product services. A good one here is, for example, communicate and collaborate more effectively with employees. That's a good corollary of social media. So there are a lot of innovative uses, and there are furthermore that come up almost every day. But that's something that we are all familiar with. I want to, like we talked about, companies using social media for promoting their products and services. But that's one use case of social media. However, a more creative instance of social media is in the reverse communication channel. That is consumers, people like you. If you are unhappy with your bank or with your mobile service provider or with the guy who delivers grocery to your home, okay, the consumer sharing information on the product or service with the vendor or among themselves. I share with you that, hey, I don't mean it, but let's say I want to complain against Big Basket to you that they are very poor at delivering. They always deliver late. Now, this becomes viral very soon. So consumer sharing information on the product or service with the vendor or amongst themselves. So that is... It's possible for a lot of people to learn about any good thing or bad thing or about a company or its product or service using social media. So a lot of companies, enterprises that you will be associating with, they are using special programs. They're called web crawlers. Web crawler is one example. There could be other softwares also, through which companies can get crucial data which offers insights into the sentiments that customers have expressed about their products or service. I mean, today, Facebook is a huge ocean. It is very difficult to find out who has written what on about a particular product. But there are software available which can extract information that has been shared about your product or company or you. Okay, and then by collating a lot of such information together, you can get a very clear idea of what customers really feel about your products and service. And that is invaluable information. Companies 20 years ago would have given their arm and tooth for such information. Because this is what enables them to stay on the edge. This is what enables them to make course corrections and improve themselves. So by using special programs like, so you basically get insight into sentiments expressed by customers on social media, analyze these and use these results for timely course corrections. In fact, I remember, a lot of you may not be familiar with this, but it was once said that a dissatisfied customer can share his dissatisfaction with 10 other customers. So basically, when a company is not being able to give good service to a customer, they are actually annoying 10 other customers, because that customer would share that information with 10 other people. With social media, it is a million other customers. You just put it on Twitter and tweet it, and in a second, it reaches the whole world. Okay, it can potentially. So imagine the impact this would have on companies' revenues and their credibility and their image. So social media becomes a very powerful tool for companies both ways, to promote their product and to understand the sentiments of customers regarding their product. So using social media as part of the business strategy is a very sound it makes very sound sense given the payback that it offers. So the two-way engagement path enables companies to measure their reach and their influence about their products, about their companies, about their reputation, about their brand equity to their market audience. And this allows them to analyze the result for timely insights and understand what customers really prefer, what are the sentiments about their products, what are their views and ideas relating to their offering. This is what helps them to improve. So it's a continuous cycle. So you can understand how critical social media is for companies which are undergoing a digital transformation. So social media, therefore, is the first element of SMAC that we spoke about. So without SMAC, digital transformation is not possible. And without social media, SMAC is not possible. So this is, I want to touch similarly upon the other parts of SMAC, time permitting. Let's talk about enterprise mobility. Perhaps for many of you, the term, though the concept must be clear, but the term enterprise mobility may not be very familiar, not as familiar as social media. Social media you can immediately relate with. Even mobility is not too difficult to relate with, actually. Mobility, contrary to the name, mobility, if you look at mobility in the dictionary, it means movement. Okay, but mobility in our context is not about movement. It is about freedom. Okay, it is about, and freedom has a direct impact on your agility. Freedom has an impact on your empowerment. It is no surprise, therefore, that mobility is making so much advances into the modern business world, because it enables freedom, it enables empowerment. We'll see how. Okay, so mobility, first of all, is a consequence of the rapid adoption of smart mobile devices. Okay, now, by a large cross-section of people. So enterprise mobility refers to the workforce. Workforce means the employees of the company using, adopting or using smart devices and using them for running business applications. So in the enterprise context, just to re-emphasize so that all of you understand what we mean by mobility, mobility means freedom from devices, platforms, networks, and of course, geography. What does it mean? Simply put, it means that access to what I hold important, for example, a document that is very important to me, is not restricted by the device that I'm holding in my hand. I can borrow tomorrow your iPad and read a document or an email that was sent to me and then log out and give it back to you. So the device is not important. Okay, it's not restricted by the device I'm holding in my hand or where my data and applications are hosted, whether they are hosted on a data center or on a cloud. It doesn't matter because mobility still enables me to access it. And most importantly, it is also agnostic to the network I'm connected to. I could be in an office local area network. I could be in a public network. I could be on a Wi-Fi network, or I could be in a mobile cellular network with 4G or 5G or whatever. It doesn't, mobility doesn't care. Basically, mobility is what enables me freedom. It doesn't care which network I am connected to or what type of network I'm connected to. And finally, it doesn't care where I am. I could be in New Delhi, I could be in Bangalore, or I could be in Timbuktu. Okay, it doesn't matter. I can still read my data and information. So that is what is freedom. You are not dependent on your place. You are not dependent on your device. You are not dependent on your network. You are not dependent on your platform. Whether you have an Apple platform or an Android platform or whatever other Windows platform, whatever you have, it doesn't matter. So basically, it is enterprise mobility or mobility, I should say. Most of the time, the term mobility, when you talk to people about what is mobility, they say mobility means BYOD. BYOD means bring your own device. So today, employees are taking their smartphone devices like an iPhone to the office and using it for both personal use also, like social interactions with their friends and families, and also for their professional activities like reading email or other the mobile applications. So that is BYOD. But BYOD is just one use case or one instance of mobility. It is wrong to reduce enterprise mobility to only BYOD. BYOD is just a use case. Now, as I said, this whole proliferation or the spread of mobile devices like smartphones and tablets has been a catalyst for mobility. And the other catalyst for mobility has been the abundance of bandwidth. I mean, today you have 100 Mbps per second at home through fiber, and even outside when you go, you easily get 5, 10, 20, 30, 40 Mbps over 4G. So that bandwidth enables you even to stream video while you are on the road. So with the basic device and network, So networks are strong, and there's already a proliferation of devices. So with this in place, it's only a matter of time before people thought that, okay, using these, you can build smart applications, okay, to leverage this for business benefits. So people use this for building applications, for example, mobile ticketing, banking, social media, etc. This all came because the enterprise infrastructure was in place, the enterprise mobility infrastructure was in place. Using that infrastructure of smart devices, bandwidth, applications were built on top of it, and that completed the enterprise mobility ecosystem, the bandwidth, the devices, and the applications. Okay, so this is what was leveraged for business. So companies adopted, airlines, for example, resorted to using to ticketing applications that could be used on the move, and basically they were leveraging mobility. So you can understand that mobility has been a critical enabler for business in the digital world. In fact, let me give you an example. This will just also break the monotony. This basically, with due respect to him, I'm not saying anything negative about anybody, but this is regarding the current Tata chairman, Mr. Chandrasekhar, or Chandra as he is called. At that time, when I, the story that I am talking about was when he was the CEO of TCS. So, in fact, I had met him. We were working very closely with TCS. I was in another Tata unit. So, he himself told me this when I was writing my book. This was at around that time. So, I actually, when I wrote about this story in my book, I talked about I didn't say TCS. I said the CEO of a well-known Indian software services company. So, basically, this gentleman was on a visit to Japan, where he was to meet one of his most important clients. Now, Japanese are very, very detail-oriented, very disciplined, very information-focused people. Okay, they're very different from people of many other countries. So this meeting was to be with six members of the senior staff of this Japanese company, which was a client of TCS. The importance of their time of these Japanese people and the need to be up to date to make the best use. They had allotted in 30 minutes for this meeting. So to make the best use of this 30 minutes was very well understood by this CEO, Chandra. So while he was on the 45 minute journey from his earlier meeting to this one, he was in Japan meeting one customer, and then there was a 45 minute drive from this customer to this other client that he was going to visit. Okay, he used a mobile enterprise application using his iPad, okay, to get a complete dossier giving the profiles with photographs of each person that he was going to meet in that meeting. So he already knew the person by face and his brief biodata of the person. And also it had information on who from TCS had met that person last, when was that person met, what was the current problem, what were the projects running, were they on time, what were the financial outstandings, and a lot of information relating to each person and their requirements was presented to him one by one as he was in the car on his tablet. Okay, this was just before, while he was going for that meeting, he was already being primed up. Who is he meeting? What are they likely to say? What is he going to reply to them? So he was much better prepared. Okay, so next it was the billing information and complaints, etc. So when the CEO arrived for the meeting, he knew everyone. He knew everyone by face, so he greeted them by name. He knew who was what, who was the director of engineering, who was the CEO, who was the CFO, and all those things. He knew what their preferences were, and he also knew what their grievances were or what their complaints were. So I think the meeting must have gone very well, as everyone, especially the Japanese, appreciate good preparation and astute management of time. And how was this possible? Through enterprise mobility. Because it was that mobility that enabled all the relevant information to appear on time on his iPad or tablet at the moment that he required it, which was crucial just before the meeting. And that resulted in the meeting going very well. Otherwise, it would not have been possible. A lot of time would have been wasted and spent in preliminaries, people introducing each other, talking about what is what. And this basically enables anybody, whether you are a frontline executive or whether you are the CEO of the company. Enterprise mobility is what is driving a lot of the digital business concepts today. So I'll try to give some examples. I think it is better to explain through examples, but unfortunately, one also needs to move fast. Let me see. I want to talk a little bit more about mobility. Okay. So basically, mobility enables the business in many ways. It's not important to read these things. These are just reasons for which enterprises embrace mobility when I made this slide. So these were the primary drivers of mobility. A quick word that I would say that in order to enable mobility or enterprise mobility, one doesn't need much. The existing device ecosystem is already there. Everybody already has mobile phones. You have a mobile network, which is already in place. You have many mobile applications are already available. So most of the requirements for introducing mobility to the workforce are already there. It is not any. However, there is one more thing which if you add, without it also it will work, but then you can add authentication, security, and some advanced feature. It's called a mobile device manager. This enables people to have features like security management and authentication, prevents fraud and misuse, etc. But to enable enterprise mobility is not very difficult for most enterprises. That's another reason that many enterprises today are adopting mobility. Let me move now. There were some other points that I wanted to talk about mobility, but there are two other concepts like big data and cloud that are very important and my favorite subjects. So let me spend 5 minutes on each of these topics. Let's talk about big data. So this is another new technology that is very relevant to the times for reasons that we shall see. Now, big data, what is big data? Many of you would already know what is big data, especially those of you from the computer science stream. But just for the benefit of everybody, let me talk about what is big data. Big data means exactly what it does. No hidden secret behind or secret meaning or hidden meaning in it. Big data means exactly that. When data becomes very big in terms of its volume, in terms of its variety, and in terms of its velocity, not just volume. People, if I have 10 gigabytes of data, so I have big data. No, that may not be true. It is not just volume. The data becomes big in terms of its volume, variety, and velocity. Remember these three V's. Okay, that is the throughput and speed of processing. That's what is velocity. Then it becomes big data. Okay, now let's see what we mean by this. Now, velocity. from all time, when we talked about in earlier classes, we talked about mainframes and mini computers and personal computers, the velocity of data was very, very small. It was called batch processing. In fact, the data was prepared external to the machine and then fed into the machine to be processed together, but there was no concept of real time. So it was not a batch processing when it was done offline. Then periodic data came in, then near real-time data came in, then real-time data came in, and now we have concepts like data host. For example, in Twitter feed, if you put, for example, somebody like our prime minister puts a poll on Twitter, within a minute, there will be 100,000 people responding to that poll. So imagine the 100,000 people from different places all over the world putting a response to a poll. So there's a lot of, it's known as a data host. There's too much data, basically, with unimaginably high volumes of data all directed at one point. So basically, we have seen that data velocity has grown from, or rather the data variety has grown in terms of, from the velocity of data, velocity for high speed data from batch to periodic to real time to data host. So there's been a consistent increase in the velocity of data. Next is the volume. Now, volume has also grown. We have seen from megabytes to gigabytes to terabytes to petabytes to exabytes. Every time three zeros have been added. Okay, so there's been an exponential growth in the volume of data. Similarly, in the variety of data, if you see earlier, that data used to be in the form of tables or flat files. Then it became databases, then it became the web came along, then now people share photos, audio, video. There is a lot of unstructured data, social media data, then a mix of all these kind of data. So there's a huge increase in the type of, in the variety of data. The veracity, that if you see on the diagram on the right, the veracity means how accurate the data, the sanctity of the data is also very important. But this particular V, I won't say is that critical as of now for this discussion. The three V's to focus on is the velocity, volume, and variety. Okay. So the V in the center of the diagram is also very important because it represents value, to unleash which we require special techniques. Now, the rate at which data is being created, if you look at the diagram in the left, is well beyond our capacity to comprehend. And this only talks about the social data, not the enterprise data. So there's a huge amount of data, but the problem is, are we able to tap into that data and analyze that data? There's a difference between data and information. Now, data is meaningless. Information is meaningful. Now, the process of analysis lies between data and information. When you analyze data, you convert it into information. Information is something which can be interpreted by people like us. Data cannot be. Okay, so that process of converting data to insights or information is basically the analysis part of it. And as I said, data is meaningless if it is not analyzed, or it cannot generate meaningful insights that can support decision making. So we are creating tons of data, but the question is that, do we have the tools to process it? That is, read it, decipher it, classify it. Now, talking about processing, the three V's we talked about, the defining characteristics of big data, you do not process big data the same way that you do normal data. Now, in case of big data, basically, how do you process such huge volumes and velocity of data? So there are techniques that are available that allow us to fragment data across multiple nodes for parallel processing. Let me explain this concept, because this is important. I'm not going into the technology, so I have an example here which explains the concept of big data processing, or how big data is analyzed and processed, without going into the technology aspect. So in the year 1999, I think it was 1999, the University of California at Berkeley conceived of a project that was nicknamed SETI at Home. I think some of you may have heard it. It was a very popular project. SETI, of course, it stands for Search for Extraterrestrial Intelligence. Okay, basically to search for intelligent signals in the vastness of deep space. It required several giant telescopes that could scan the skies and detect even the weakest of radio emissions with remarkable sensitivity and send them to a centralized computer which could record all of them and analyze them. Now, the problem was that somewhere in this huge amount of radio noise that was received, there could be a signal sent by intelligent beings who could be light years away. Now, unfortunately, finding this small bit of data, or as I say, a needle in a haystack, was extremely difficult even with the most powerful computers in existence at that time. So how to solve this problem? I mean, you don't have enough processing capacity or computing power to be able to detect those signals. So they struck on a brilliant idea. They said, why not turn to a massively underutilized computing resource, which was basically the millions of personal computers, like my laptop or your laptop and other laptops, which are sitting on desks in offices all the world over, laptops and desktops, having nothing to do but running mindless screensavers. They're not, their CPU power is not being utilized. So they thought that if all of them could connect to this project, we could use the idle CPU power of the various thousands and millions of computers all the world over to partially process this data, basically send the data to them in fragment, let them process it and send it back to the central computer. That will save the power and processing requirement for the central computer. So this worked very well. In fact, anybody with a PC or a laptop could enlist as a participant in the SETI at home. It did not read your data or what is in your disk drive or local computer, but it worked in the background. You would not even come to know of it. Okay, to process the mountain of data, and that solved much of their city's computing power in a minute. That is, they embarked upon the idea of fragmenting the vast data which was received and assigning it to multiple nodes or computers. Okay, processing it in parallel and finally feeding the processed data back to the centralized computer over the internet. Nobody even came to know of it, but they solved the problem in a remarkable way. They used the computers, ordinary computers all the world over to process such huge repositories of information. So this was a brilliant idea. And this is the idea that has given rise to big data analysis. Big data analysis also work in a similar way. The traditional algorithms that are used for processing information require the information to be in main memory. I think you might have studied this in your IT architecture classes, and it's accessed through a single CPU. In big data analytics, the sheer size and diversity of data does not allow it all to be in memory at the same time. You cannot have terabytes or exabytes of data in your RAM, right? So, and hence it calls for distributed processing across a host of systems. The diagram at the bottom right, there are technologies like Hadoop available, or Apache, which are available for doing this. I'm not going into those technologies. Now, this is a very special, now, this distributed processing of data to create insights, which is how big data is processed, is a very specialized discipline, which has given rise to a new branch of study. It is called data science. Basically, which studies ways to extract insights from big data using advanced processes and algorithms. So this is essentially, so data is becoming a primary lever for gaining competitive advantage. And one of the most visible the use cases of big data, it has spawned new technologies. One of the greatest technologies that is spawned by big data is artificial intelligence. Artificial intelligence is not a science of logical processing, but more of, it has more to do with big data. Okay, so it has spawned these new technologies like machine intelligence, machine learning and artificial intelligence. And the trend, but more importantly for the business sense, it is used. This technique that we briefly talked about is used for behavior analysis of various customer segments and then to target them for marketing and services. This has been one of the main sort of pull factors for enterprise adoption of big data analytics. It leads to smarter marketing campaigns and better management of customer experience. So this is basically about big data. Essentially, the thing to remember is that the three V's are important: the velocity of data, which has changed over time, the volumes of data, which have also changed over time, and the variety of data, which has grown from tables to unstructured format or that we see today. So there are a lot of use cases. It is not processed in the same way that you process RDBMS or simple databases. So it requires special processing techniques, which are known as, which use big data analytics. And big data analytics works through the medium of parallel processing over several nodes and fragmenting data into several nodes and processing them simultaneously. These are some of the key concepts that you must remember. And it has been one of the big enablers of new technologies and in enabling businesses to understand their customers better. Lastly, this last 2 minutes, we'll talk about cloud. Cloud is not something new for most people. Cloud refers to a remote cluster of computing resources, as we have already talked about, which are accessed over a secure network. The cloud computing model, basically the core technology behind cloud computing, is the technology known as virtualization. Cloud computing creates a virtual instance of the app or data on your local device. So you don't care whether the application is running on your, so even a 5,000 rupee phone can run software, which is like SAP, which costs millions of dollars. Okay, because it's not residing on your device, but virtually you see it on your device only. So thus, if your data and applications are cloud, you make yourself independent of the device. This is essentially what it does. Cloud-based computing resources typically hosted by a cloud service provider who provides them to you on a chargeable basis or on a subscription or usage basis. Like, for example, you get electricity or water. Similarly, the cloud service provider can charge you for the cloud services. Now, quickly going into the reasons of it, one of the reasons that cloud computing has become popular with enterprises is the freedom. I wish I had time to go through this graph, but basically there are organizations face a lot of fluctuations in demand. Okay, so it allows the freedom from having to worry about changes in demands or about maintenance and obsolescence, because the cloud service is offered as a service. It is known as infrastructure as a service. So people have some concerns about security on the cloud, but then I think I'm sure that when banks started for the first time, people would have concerned about putting their money on with a bank also. But over time, these concerns get tided over. But the important thing to know about the cloud is that that the cloud enables enterprises to lease computing resources as a service. This is what is important. It therefore frees the companies from worries of support, obsolescence, depreciation, capacity planning, etc. And finally, the cloud can be, just to look at the other, the cloud can be a private cloud, a public cloud, or a hybrid cloud. Now, a private cloud, all resources within a private cloud operate with the sole purpose of providing a service to one company only. In other words, a private cloud is a single tenancy model of the cloud. This is analogous to hosting your data in your own private data center. It may be a private data center, or it can be hosted by a third party, which is connected to your company through a high-speed network, okay, which is known as a co-location service or infrastructure as a service. But it is essentially, in both cases, it's a private network. By contrast, a public cloud is a multi-tenancy cloud computing environment where each client shares the computing resources with several other clients. For example, we use iCloud or OneDrive, or in enterprise context, we use Salesforce.com or Siebel CRM. These are basically hosted on a cloud, and many people are using different instances of it, which are not interfering with each other. Okay, a hybrid cloud is basically a cloud computing environment, like we have shown here. It makes use of a mix of the both. Some part of it they use on their own, where there is more sensitivity or ease of use, and some part, some of the software is basically on the public cloud, so which may be shared with other people. So basically, the hybrid model is preferred because it offers the best of both worlds. Essentially, so this is basically a as we have seen on the top left. If you see, the cloud has been the result of progressive evolutions in technology, from mainframe to personal computers, which we have talked about in the past classes, to client-server computing, web, and finally the latest and the most disruptive version of technology is the cloud. So this is where we currently are, and on the right we have some advantages of that cloud offers, many of which you are familiar with. I wanted to cover this. Luckily, as I said, that this is not something that that is unfamiliar to you. Some of the points that I may have spoken about may be new. But you have to, essentially, the point here is that you have to put it all in context, because this is something that is the life and death of the business world of today. Without understanding these concepts and without imbibing them as your second nature, it is very difficult to grow in business today. These are, of course, the fundamentals are important, no doubt about it. And without having a strong fundamentals, you cannot reach up to this point. But these things are also very essential to know, because we are living in a new economy, and that new economy also affects the skills that are required and what people seek in their current and future employees. Lastly, this is not a slide really that I want to talk about, but I want to leave this with you. How can you convert an idea? If you have an idea today, basically, this is how the digital, you can apply social media, whatever the technologies that we talked about, social, mobile, cloud, analytics, to create a digitization strategy, which in turn would result in digital experiences leading to happy customers and finally the competitive advantage. One of the assignments I would like to leave you with, and I could probably communicate it with you separately, is to use this slide to convert any idea. You can have any idea. Basically, that idea could be to sell vegetables, or that idea could be to devise a new transportation service from point A to point B, or it could be one of millions or trillions of ideas that you can get. How would you use digital technologies or SMAC to convert that idea into a competitive advantage? For suppose you were to set up a startup today, how would you, basically this is what you would be doing, what is shown here in this diagram. It's a very simplified diagram, of course, but I want you to use the simplified way for now and see how you can use whatever we talked about today to convert an idea into a competitive advantage. So I think we are just about on time. Thank you. I'm about 4 minutes late. So sorry about that. So I hope, I'm sorry that we had to go very fast through this, but I hope that whatever we discussed made some sense. Thank you very much.
Any question? Ashish, we have still a few more minutes because class...
I was there till 12:20 and by my watch it is 12:25.
Yeah, 12:30 we can go up to. Any question?
So if there is anything that I wish we could have talked more about mobility. I wanted to talk about certain more things, but I think some other class I'll cover it. Any ideas or questions or suggestions or points of view that because these are, as I have been repeatedly saying, these are very, very important. This is the language of tomorrow. It's like not knowing the language and trying to survive in the world. So this is similar to that. All these things are, today they may seem a little bit esoteric, but actually believe me, they are survival. Some of these skills which Dr. Mittal talked about earlier about networks and Moore's law and some of those other things and the points that we have discussed in the past, like digital economy or digital transformation and SMAC, these are extremely critical survival skills, I would say. So if you have any points now, you can ask me now, or even if you want to ask me later, you're most welcome.
Yeah, and in fact, you can see this model being used by different enterprises, right? For example, Amazon, right? How Amazon is using social, mobile, cloud analytics, right? Analytics is not visible to us, but I'm sure with every purchase that you do, they are collecting enough information to send you, you know, more details or advertisements. Okay.
Good. Right.
Yeah. Any questions?
Thank you very much. Thank you. I'll see you on Monday.
All right.
Okay. Bye.
Bye-bye. Bye.